Welcome guys. This is another session of mathematics grade 12 with myself, Joel and Nemlalas. So today we'll be covering your inverse functions on your grade 12 curriculum. So I'm first going to try to define what are inverse functions. So basically, inverse functions is when you have a function, an original function, say for instance, maybe y is equal to 2x minus 1, and the inverse of that function would be a form of that equation where the domain and the range have been interchanged. Remember, the domain we are referring to the x values, while in the range we are referring to the y values. So I said in the inverse function, it will be a form of this equation or of this function that will be interchanged in the domain and the range. So if I were told to write the equation of the inverse of that function, these are the steps I would follow. First is to interchange y and x. So in the place of y, I put x. In the place of x, I put y minus 1. So if I solve for y to make y the subject of the equation, what I would get would be my equation of my inverse function. So dividing by 2 both sides for that, I'd get positive 1 over 2x plus 1 over 2. So that equation, guys, is the equation of my inverse function. This one is the function, and that one is the equation of the inverse of that function. So in functions, we have a function notation. Remember, we said a function of s is the same as y. So this represents the function of x, but the inverse notation will be f to the minus 1 of x, to mean this is the inverse function of that f. So if I were told to write down the equation of the inverse function for any equation, guys, you follow the following steps. You interchange x and y, then you solve for y. The equation will be written in that form unless stated otherwise on your question paper, guys. So I'm just going to first to draw that, maybe graph, to illustrate a little bit more about inverse function. So I'm having that function of 2x minus 1. It would I'm just guessing how it would look like. Definitely it would be something like this, guys. So that is my function of y is equal to 2x minus 1. So if I were to also draw that equation, that inverse function, it would be something, I'm guessing something like this. But it should not touch with that one. I was just trying to make it steeper, guys. So that would be the equation of the function of the inverse for that function. It's half x plus half. So another thing, guys, about the inverse function. The inverse functions, guys, the inverse of the function is always the reflection of the function itself on that imaginary line we call y is equal to x. So the line y is equal to x is something like that. So any inverse function, guys, is a reflection of the function about that line y is equal to x. So I hope you got that. That will help you later when you come across the point of intersections of the function and its inverse. So I hope you got all that for now. So I'm just going to quickly move to another thing. So if we were to write guys the domain of that original function we are having, I think you'd all agree with me that it is x is an element of all real values. So that is the domain for any straight line, guys. And if I were to write the range for that function, it would also be y is an element of all real values. That is the domain for any straight line function. So if I were told now, guys, to write the domain of the function, remember what we said we did here. We interchanged the domain, and the range, So in the first part, I showed you how to find the equation of a function. You noticed that in the place of y, I substituted with x, and in the place of x, I substituted with y. So we say we have interchanged the domain and the range. So that is true, guys. If you were asked to write down the domain for the inverse function, since the domain is x, you are going to take that range of the function to be the domain of the inverse. So x is an element of all real values there. So write down the range. Now the range then is y. So my range is now the domain. The range of my inverse is the domain of my original function. So I hope you all saw that clearly. Let alone that we had the same answers, because it is true for the inverse of a function. Now guys, at the beginning of this video, I forgot to introduce these inverse topics. These inverse functions are more easily. I wanted to talk about first on what is a function, guys. A function, we describe it as a relation between the domain, that is the x value, and the y value, guys. So a function is any relation between the domain and the range. So if I'm having that graph of y is equal to 2x minus 1, I had drawn it here, it was something like this. You'd say that for every x value I'm having there, x could be minus 1 there, but I'm only having one y value. For every x value I'm having there, there is a corresponding one y value, guys. So we say a function, in order for a graph to be a function, for every x value there should be a corresponding y value, guys. So that is what we are saying now. How to test a graph, if it is a function, we use something we call the vertical line test. So basically the vertical line test, guys, is an imaginary vertical line that is drawn parallel to the y-axis. So it is a line like that. So if that line, guys, if you draw that vertical line through any graph, if that line touches that graph more than once, that graph is not a function, guys. So for instance, if I was having a graph like that, and I were to draw my vertical line test, you could see that my vertical line only intersected with that graph at one point only. So you could conclude there that that graph is a function. Why? Because the vertical line test cut the graph at only one point. What if we had something like this, guys, or maybe a circle for that matter? So if I were to draw a vertical line through that circle, you see it would touch the circle at 2 points. So for that circle, we see it is not a function. Why? The vertical line test intersects the graph more than once, or at least at 2 points. So I hope you got that, guys. Or if you're asked to determine whether a graph is a function, you draw the vertical line test. So on the types of functions we are having, a one-to-one relation, and a many-to-one relation. So a one-to-one relation, guys, is simply a straight line graph of that form y is equal to mx plus c. A many-to-one is a graph of the parabola of that form. So why are we saying The graph of the parabola is a many to one. Remember, if I'm having an equation like that, y is equal to x squared, I'm going to put it in that form. So we are saying, in order for a graph to be a function, for every one x value, there should be one y value, guys. So what about the parabola? In a parabola, you could be, in a case where you are having x is equal to minus 1 or x is equal to positive 1. So if I had two values of x and I substituted minus 1 in that equation, I'd get positive 1. Also, if I substituted that positive 1, I'd also, guys, get a positive 1. So that is why we are saying the parabola is a many to one function. So we are saying for many values of x, we are having only one y value. So we are saying now the inverse of a one-to-one relation, that is the inverse of the straight line graph, which I had just illustrated here, is also a function, guys. We come now to the many-to-one function and its inverse. So the graph of the parabola, you could be given anything in that form, y is equal to x squared, or rather, let me write it in this form, function of x is equal to x squared. So that graph in a sketch, guys, is something like that. The turning point has to be at zero there. So that is the function of x, guys. Now, if you are told to write down or at least find the equation of the inverse of f, so what did you say we do? This is the place of y, we substitute and put x. In the place of x, we put y, then we solve for y in order to find the new equation. So here we have to divide by, sorry, not divide by, square root both sides and put a plus or minus there and have an equation y is equal to plus or minus root of x. So if you were to draw that equation, guys, it would be something of that shape. It will be something of that shape. So this is the graph of the inverse function of x. Remember, we said we write f inverse of x as the notation of the inverse. Remember, you should only write in this format if you are only told so in a question paper. You could be told to write the equation of the inverse in the form y is equal to something. In that case, this will be in vain, guys. So we are coming to the inverse of the what? Of the parabola or of the many to one function. So if you are looking at my parabola there, if you were to draw this, what we call the vertical line test, you could see that that vertical line touches the graph only at one point. So we are saying the many to one function or the parabola is a function. Why? Because the vertical line test cuts the graph at only one point, guys. What about its inverse? What about the inverse of the graph of the parabola or the graph of a many to one function? If you were to draw the vertical line test there, you could see that my vertical line there has intersected with that function at 2 points, or at least at more than 1 point. So we say if a vertical line test intercepts the graph more than once, then that graph is definitely not a function, guys. So we come to exactly that, to talk about the inverse, guys, of the what? Of the parabola, on how to make it a function, guys. Remember, we said an inverse is a reflection of the function about the line y is equal to x. So if I were to draw that line, guys, I'm trying to make it clear here. So if I were to draw that line y is equal to x, it would have to cut there at the middle. So you could see I'm having this side and this side. So this side has reflected itself on this side has reflected itself there, and so on and so forth, guys. So we are saying an inverse function is a reflection of a function about the line y is equal to x for any inverse function, guys. So we come to how we can make the inverse of a parabola or the inverse of a many-to-one, a function, guys, because we've agreed that the inverse of a many-to-one or of a parabola is definitely not a function. Now, they can ask you this in a question, guys, you'll be required to write down words for the first time in mathematics as to how can we make the inverse of a parabola a function. So this is how it goes, guys. In that function, we are having f of x is equal to x squared, the original function we had, guys. So if I were to write down, guys, the domain for that function, domain, you'll find out the domain for that function is x is an element of all real values. If I were to write the range, the range would be something like y is greater, yes, is greater or equal to 0. So if you are looking at that domain, it says any x value is catered for in that function. So it means I can range from negative infinity up to positive infinity, guys. So this is how it comes on how to make the inverse of a parabola a function. We say we restrict the domain of the parabola, guys. So we say we restrict the domain of the function, of the function. Now, guys, what does it mean to restrict? Remember, restrict, prohibit, forbidden are the same thing. So if you are, guys, if you are forbidden to do something, you cannot do it. So to restrict is to set certain boundaries that cannot be that cannot be broken, guys, or that cannot be overruled or something like that. So if I tell you that you will only leave the house at 4 o'clock, I've restricted you in the house for that certain time. So you are not allowed to go outside until 4 o'clock. So how do we restrict the domain? Remember, the domain are the x values. So the domain was x is an element of all real values from negative infinity to positive infinity. So you'll have to at least take one side if you want your x to be positive, guys, because you can see clearly on that function that we are having x on the negative side of the those x's, and we are also having a positive x on the right side of the x's. So if we said our x must be greater or equal to 0, we are only restricting the graph to only have positive values of x, guys. I hope you are getting this. So if we are only having positive values of x, guys, on that function, let me clear this vertical line. So that is our y there, that is our x. So if you are restricting, remember, this is the function, we are having this wing on the negative x, we are having that side on the positive x. So if we are saying we should only have the x is greater or equal to 0, we are saying we should only have this wing, this one going to that side. We are saying we should not have this wing. So imagine if this side was to be reflected, this side was to be reflected, this is the reflection or the inverse of that side. So we'd not have this side. If you restrict this side on the function, this side will not be there on the inverse. So take a look at our inverse now. We're only having that side. So if I draw a vertical line, you could see that it cuts the graph only once. I know I've said a lot and maybe it has complicated everything I've been doing here, but you can pause the video, go back. So I'm going to add on how to restrict the domain of the function to make the the inverse of the function to be also a function. So you could also pick x is less or equal to 0. So this is what you exactly write, guys. If they ask you how to restrict the domain of the function in order for its inverse to be a function, you say you restrict the domain for the of the function for. And you say for, after writing for x is less or is greater or equal to 0, if you like, you or you could pick this side, x is less or equal to 0. So I think I've tried to explain that. I'm just going to move to the inverse of an exponential function, guys. So before I get on the inverse of the exponential function, I want to first talk a little bit about logs. So remember, we said in exponents, in fact, we said you could write 2 to the power of 2 as 4, 2 to the power of 3 as maybe 8, not maybe, in fact, as 8. So guys, the log function is actually the opposite of the what? Of the exponential function. So we used our exponents there. 2 is our exponent there. So 2 raised to the exponent 2 is actually equal to 4. But what if I didn't know what that 2 was and I had 2 to the power of x, which was, it would be equal to 4. Without using that guy, that law of exponents, writing 2 squared, 2 to the x, having x is equal to 2 and all that, you could also use a logarithm function there. So this is how the logarithm function works. I'm just going to write this as y is equal to log, maybe 2, let's say base x. So I'm reading that as y is equal to log 2 base x. So how I read it, guys, is actually important because it's not going to give you any difficulties when you come to writing the equation of an inverse of an exponential function. So I read this as y is equal to log of 2 base x. Now, if you were to look at this, this is actually our base, our 2 there is our base, and our x is our exponent. Exponent. Our 4 there, we could say it is a constant. So the logarithm works in this way, guys. It says if you want to find any exponent is equal to the log of the constant, then you write the base there. So any exponent is equal to the log of the constant, then you write the base, guys. So imagine if I were to figure out what this n was. Remember I said x is equal to, so in this equation, if you wanted to solve for x, that is the exponent, our x there would be equal to log of that constant, guys, 4 and base 2. So if you actually press this, I'm sure you'll get a value of 2 because I took it from there, guys. So I hope I tried to introduce a little bit of that. Again, I'm just going to write another one. If I'm having 2 to the power of x is equal to 7 and I wanted to write that x as the subject of the formula, I'd say my exponent is equal to my log of my constant 7, then here my base of 2. I hope you got that. You are going to need that skill in the next few seconds. So guys, we come to the exponential graph, guys. You could be given any exponential graph of that form, y is equal to 2 to the power of x. And the first question maybe they will ask you is to write down the equation of the inverse. Or perhaps you may be given f of x. Let me put it in that form. They say write the equation of the inverse of f in that form, y is equal to something. So for all functions, guys, we follow the same rules. First mark, new interchange, we'll have a mark there. So in the place of y, I'm going to put x. in the place of X, I'm going to put Y. Now we are back to that as equation. I said if you had 2 to the power of X is equal to 4, the way in order, the way to write the exponent as the subject of the equation would be X is equal to log of the constant base 2. So we are actually here now. We have to make Y the subject of the formula, guys. So help me out here. Y is equal to log of the constant base 2, guys. So it is simple as that. So if ever you are going to have any difficulties in following these logarithms laws, you are going to have a problem, guys. Now I come to the sketch of that function. If I were to sketch that function, guys, it would be something, I'm guessing something like this. That is my equation, my f of x. So I said for any function, guys, its inverse is a reflection about this line. This line y is equal to x. So that is my imaginary line there, y is equal to x, and that is my f of x. Now what we did here is to write, guys, the equation of the inverse of that function. Now if they tell me to draw, guys, come on, if they tell me to draw the graph of the inverse, you do not need to suffer or sweat by trying to calculate your x-intercept or y-intercept there, because we said in the inverse, the relationship between the inverse and its function is the interchanging part. So if you are to calculate the x-intercept there by putting y is equal to 0, I don't think you'd be having an x-intercept. But for a y-intercept, you are surely having there one. It will always be the case for the exponential function, guys. Your y-intercept will always be in that point 0 is to 1. It will always be, guys. So if I were to maybe try to draw the sketch of that inverse, and I needed points, so since we are having the points in that form 0 is to 1, you know in the inverse we interchange, so you'd have to interchange that in order to get coordinates that correspond on your inverse. Make your y to be x, my x is 1 now, make your x to be y, my y is 0 now. So you could see it could be something passing there. So if I completely draw this graph, it will be something like that, guys. So you could say that that graph, which is of the inverse f negative of x, is actually the reflection of that function. Is the reflection of that function about that line y is equal to x, guys. So I hope this session was helpful, guys. It's a pity for you, I don't have any questions we can attempt, or better yet, I've just thought of one other trick that could be helpful. So for any function, guys, I've said that it is true that the inverse of a function is actually the reflection of its function about the line y is equal to x. Now, guys, there is a question that really comes where they will ask you the point of the intersection of the inverse and its function. You are having maybe an equation f of x is 2 to the power of x and f negative of x as maybe log of x base 2. Now they ask you, guys, to solve the point of intersection of it, or maybe to write down the point of intersection for the function and its inverse. Guys, I'm sure you could all be puzzled, because you know in the point of intersection you equate the equations. So This thing here seems a lot more difficult to deal with. So I'm coming with a solution that is more easy. I do not sweat you for any function, guys. This is applicable. So it is true, guys, for any function and its inverse that they will always be equal to that equation. So at the point of intersection of the x of the inverse and its function also is the intersection with that imaginary line we said is reflected about. So what I'm trying to say now is that if you are trying to find the point of intersection for any inverse and its function, you should always consider the first function to be y is equal to x, because I said that the point of intersection of the inverse and its function will also be the point of intersection with both graphs with the what? With that imaginary line. So this will be considered as your first graph at any point of intersection. So trying to solve this, I'd have to equate my y is equal to x and my y is equal to 2 to the power of x. Maybe it could make your life easier. So thank you, guys. This is it for this video. Please don't forget to subscribe, guys, and share the link of this video. Please, your help or your cooperation would be very much appreciated. Thank you, guys, and good night.